Exactly.
I didn't do that before. Now I have that.
Thank you.
Good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
Good to see you all here. I was saying this morning that organizing something like this is basically dealing with one crisis after another for a year straight. And what's that? So I heard. And that seems to be pretty much true. So thank you all for being here. I hope you have a great time. And I'd like to introduce Elizabeth. Where is Elizabeth?
Oh.
I'm looking around. I didn't see you.
It's been a long night, guys. Who's going to open us up with our keynote this morning?
Also also not one of the Ubuntu core developers. He's not a Ubuntu developer, strictly. He's just a contributor who was wanted to work on Unity, and he submitted a patch and made a huge difference. So quick question for everyone in the audience. Who contributes to open source already? Okay, that's a fair number. Who's interested in contributing? Who has never really thought about it? Okay, that's a very good mix. Good. So I wanted to start with talking about getting involved by talking a little bit about how open source is organized and pays for it. It's really hot in here. With organization and money in open source, there is really a whole wide open field of variation between projects. You might have a project that was started by someone in her basement, but she wrote up a script in 2 hours and tossed it on SourceForge and never thought about it again. In that case, you wouldn't really say it's organized in any way, really. You wouldn't say anyone paid for it because she just wrote it instead of watching Futurama that night. So that's one side of the spectrum. On the other side, you've got big corporations, Red Hat. You've got smaller companies like Canonical. You have nonprofits, the Mozilla Foundation, the Open Document Foundation, that are out there. And these are big organizations and companies who are behind an open source project. There's a lot of organization. There's a lot of levels of people working on the project. And then between those two extremes, you've got everything in between. You've got small companies contributing to open source projects. So when you get involved in a project, it's good asking, looking at the project, figuring out how it's organized, learning who pays for it, because that can impact your involvement and how much you can contribute. For people who haven't really thought about it or whatnot, I'm going to go through some why you would contribute reasons. Parties, but. In spite of that picture with a cowboy hat, I'm not much of a party person. That was just a very fun night. that was at the Ubuntu Developer Summit in Dallas. The other two pictures are from a release party in San Francisco. So I wanted to start off with this, even though it may not be appealing to everyone, because there's this misconception that open source people are antisocial and don't get out and talk to people, and they don't go to conferences, and they're all really pale. Some of us are really pale. that they just don't socialize, and it's a very solitary life, and open source contributing is not something you do a lot with friends. But really, there is a lot of socialization, and inside a project, especially the larger projects, you get to know a lot of people, and you're always working with people, whether it be online or at developer summits or conferences. So you're working with people a lot. Most of the friends I have now are people I met through open source, just because I spent so much time with them, and I travel to Philadelphia on really hot days to see them and go to conferences with them. It's very social and it's very fun. So it gave me the opportunity to do things like travel. I have included a picture of Philly on this slide. I'm here today. Depending on what projects you get involved with, you may also get sponsorships to conferences. I went to London a couple years ago on a sponsorship from Google, who was sponsoring people to go to this open source conference. These are also pictures of Brussels and Budapest. I went to Ubuntu Developer Summits in those cities, and I was sponsored by Canonical to go to those. It was limited out of pocket, and then I got to go to Europe and go on a trip. At these summits and conferences, you also don't have to. I mean, all day you're spent at a conference or a work group, especially with the Ubuntu Developer Summit, you're exhausted by the end of the day. But you're in a foreign country, so it's fun to go out. So every night we'd go out and do tourist event, or we'd do some anything in the city. When we were in Budapest, I actually contacted the Hungarian Ubuntu team in the area because I knew one of the members, and she organized two events. On Wednesday, we went to an exhibition, and then on Thursday, we did this whole tourism night, which is where I took this one picture down the left corner there. Opportunities to travel, pretty good. So this slide's kind of crazy. It's got a lot of stuff on it. Another reason to contribute is the opportunity to learn more. Learning things for open source projects can go anywhere from reading a book that you bought or downloading some some information about a project, to more solid mentoring programs. Google Summer of Code is a good example of this. If you're a student, every year, Google asks open source projects to submit applications to be involved in this program, and then they go out and reach out to students who may want to be involved. From there, Google will approve a bunch of open source projects and pair up students with the projects, and then they have the summer to complete a certain task within the project. The open source project benefits from having someone exposed to their project, which means they may contribute longer, but at the very least, having a paid contributor for the summer, because Google pays the student internship stipends. So that's actually one of the best programs within open source for generic mentoring across a bunch of projects. But some open source projects also have their own mentoring programs. I'm pretty sure KDE has one. Yeah. Ubuntu has several across a bunch of different teams. I work with the Ubuntu Women Project, and we work with a lot of women who are getting involved in the project. Because as you can see from this room, actually, it's a pretty male-dominated environment. And it can be intimidating for some women who are getting involved. So we pretty much offer encouragement and mentoring and getting them on the right track when they're trying to find a way to contribute. Obviously, I do a lot of work with Ubuntu, so I've got a bunch of examples from them. That project also does things like Ubuntu Developer Week, which is a series of sessions in chat where you get to talk to real Ubuntu developers. They'll do a presentation on a certain subject. For instance, they usually start off the Developer Week with a quick packaging session to tell you how to start getting involved in Ubuntu development. And then from beyond that, they've got an App Developer Week for people looking to get their application into Ubuntu. They have Ubuntu Open Week, which showcases a lot of different projects within the Ubuntu project and shows you how to get involved and raise awareness for them. So lots of really awesome ways to learn. I don't have pretty pictures for this slide, unfortunately. but experience is a huge one for a lot of people. Especially students who are getting ready to graduate, or people looking to change careers, or at least change the focus of their career. Working on open source projects can be a really good way to get experience. It's important to remember when you contribute to an open source project, you're working on real software that is deployed to people, in sometimes an enterprise environment. So it's a real software product. So you're working with real revision control tools, documentation frameworks, programming languages, and other things that you would work work with in a normal job. So you can put it on your resume. Companies will often look at open source work when they're looking to hire you. It gives you code samples, it gives you experience working with groups, so they can get a pretty good idea of your character from your open source contributions, and that can really help you get a job. So experience is a very good reason. And then making a difference for people, whether it be millions or thousands or just a few people maybe. It feels really good when you talk to someone who's actually been using your software and if you fixed a bug that was important and they say thank you, it feels really good. While I do a lot of work with Ubuntu, especially with the community council, it can sometimes feel a little bit removed from people actually using the software. That's one of the reasons I got involved with Artemis, because even though the things I do may actually impact a lot of people, I don't always see it. I started working with Artemis because I was able to actually get down on the ground and see the teachers and students who are using the computers that they might not otherwise have. And it's a really good feeling. And at the bottom of the slide, I said, tiny little letters in parentheses, or just you. But upon thinking about it, I probably should have made that its own slide and made it really big, because a lot of people and corporations and companies that contribute to open source are not doing it because they have some altruistic goal or anything. They're doing it because they needed something fixed, or they needed a new feature in the project, and they decided to contribute that feature back, so they don't have to maintain it forever. So making a difference for just yourself or the company you work for is a really good reason to contribute back. And it's nice to not have to maintain that patch forever if you give it back. Now that you're interested in possibly contributing, because there's lots of awesome things about contributing, I'm just going to talk a little bit about the kinds of ways you can contribute. This one is the most obvious. If you have an open source software project, you need someone to write the software. So programmers of all kinds, obviously very, very useful. Another way is working with bugs. reporting bugs to writing patches and bugs. Depending on the project, you might have a really small project where the lead developer looks at every single bug and fixes them himself. Or you might have a really large project, like Ubuntu or similar, where you have a whole team of bug people. working on fixing bugs, and they'll start with triaging a bug, which pretty much means a bug report comes in from an individual. They'll make sure the bug report has all the information, make sure it's filed against the right package within the Ubuntu project, and then once it's all finished and it's replicatable and all that, they'll forward it on to the developers and patch writers who can then make a fix, hopefully. So there are a lot of little ways you can get involved. If you want to do patch writing is an interesting way to get involved and really get familiar with the source code of a project and the code workflow that they're using. So then you might be able to contribute in different ways moving forward. Documentation. So your project may be awesome, but it's not great if no one can figure out how to use it. So documentation, very, very important. One of the first ways I got involved in a way that would have been reflected in a changelog was back in 2005. I installed a software called Beetlebee. I don't know if anyone's familiar with it. It's a messenger gateway for IRC. So all your instant messenger windows pop up in your IRC client, which is awesome because I hate instant messenger windows that pop up all over my screen because I lose them on other desktops and people yell at me for ignoring them. And so Beetlebee was really important to me and really awesome when I found. So when I discovered it, I decided to join their IRC channel, because as I mentioned, I love IRC, and I'm in like a million channels. So I'm sitting in their channel for about a month, and people come in with support requests, and I'm helping them out as they come in, because I've been using it, you know, a full 2 weeks longer than that, so I know how to do things like add users and everything. So I'm doing support work there. And then the lead developer of the project, Homer, mentioned that the Quick Start Guide, which is the documentation within the software itself, really needed updating. And I wrote it when I first started the project, and I upgraded the documentation, and I really need someone to rewrite this. So I'm sitting there, and I'm like, how hard can that be? Okay, worst lesson? It's actually kind of hard to write documentation, but, you know. Anyway, I volunteered, because I'm like, I'll do it, you know. I was very naive. So I volunteered to work on it, and once I figured out, you know, how to get this done, I had the stuff written, and then I went to download the source code, and it was fine, and I opened up the XML file, which turned out to be a docbook. Docbook is an XML-based documentation framework, and it's XML, so you can sort of figure out where things are if you look at other places in the file, but it was another thing I had to learn, so I was like, well, that's interesting. So I got the documentation written, I wedged it into Docbook, and it was all okay, and I mentioned to the lead developer, I'm like, hey, how do I give this to you? And he was nice enough to just allow me to email it, so I emailed it to him, and he got it in the thing. It was a really good feeling, because when the next release came out, there was a changelog entry saying the docs have been updated, I was added to the credits file, and I was like, wow, that's super exciting. And that's a dinosaur? But more importantly, maybe not more important, more to the point, that's me and Wilmer. This was actually taken at Google. So this is in 2008. So we've been working on Beetlebee for about 3 years together, and we both happened to be in Mountain View at the time, because he was working at Google by then, and I was visiting a friend. And so we decided to meet up for lunch. So he's a friend now. We've also met up in New York City since, and we meet up sometimes, and we chat, and we talk, and it's a lot of fun. So friends, again. I mentioned when I started working with Bitly, I was doing support stuff. It wasn't really something I intentionally set out to do. I'm not like, I'm joining and doing support now. It just happened to be that I was sitting in the channel and I was bored, or I, you know, knew the answer and thought I could tell someone. But the more I thought about it, support is a really, really important thing for open source projects. Usually community support offered by volunteers is often the only support people will get for an open source piece of software. So it's first of all, it's very important because there's no company that can call usually unless they're calling like a contracting firm that does a lot of open source work to get support. So first of all, it's very important. Second of all, it's got a really low barrier to entry. So as long as you know, like, you know, I've been using GitHub for 2 weeks and I was able to start helping people immediately because they didn't know how to add a new user and I did. So it's got a low barrier to entry. As long as you know a little bit more than some of the people asking questions, you can help out. It's not got a big investment of time involved. You can commit as much time or as little time to support as you want. You can take a vacation for 3 months and no one will, you know, complain that you're no longer offering support because support people will come and go. And while some of them are very important, if you're a new contributor, it's really easy to just help out as you have time. Another reason support work in open source is really important and really good is there are lots of different forms of support for various projects. So if you don't like chat very much, maybe you're a forums person. A lot of projects now have forums that they offer support on. Maybe you're a mailing list person. A lot of people really love mailing lists. So if you want to support a mailing list, there's also things like Stack Exchange, which is on our website. Well, to me, it's very forums-like, but I'm sure Stack Exchange devotees will tell me I'm wrong. It's a web-based question and answer system, all like Yahoo answers. So you can up and down vote answers. It's a very interesting site. But it's another way to get to support, and then it's definitely important. We've got testing. So I used to do a lot more Debian package maintaining, and one of the Debian packages I used to maintain was this PHP-based application. It was a web app, a calendaring software. And in this web app, it supported three SQL backends. It was Postgres, MySQL, and SQLite. Since it was a PHP app, I'm sorry to say, it required a lot of patches to make it work in Debian. And for security patches that never got applied upstream, or security patches that weren't applied upstream fast enough for us to be happy with them. So every time we wanted to build this package, we needed to make sure the database adding stuff in Debian, our Debian scripts, was done properly and fixed up. We had to apply all these 16 or 17 patches against the piece of software, and then we needed to do testing. I learned very quickly that I'm not really much of a testing person, so I ended up with this list of little things I needed to test every single time we did a release. So every time we did a release, I'd go through this list, and it was tedious, and it was boring, and I hated doing it, and I complained about it. So one time, this friend of mine told me that he was bored. Never, ever tell me you're bored, because I have a list to do this and I will give you one of those things. So, the thing on my list that day was testing the latest release of this web application. So I handed him off the new source code and I gave him my checklist. And I had actually already, you know, did a quick look over it. There weren't many changes. I didn't think there were any bugs. I was like, oh, just test this for me one last time before I do the release. And he found a bunch of bugs that I completely missed. First of all, I was really upset about this because I was like, what did I do wrong, right? But it turns out the problem was not actually that I, you know, packaged a horrible thing. It was that my testing methodology was somewhat flawed because as someone developing the product, I sort of had
blind spots?
Yeah, blind spots. And I had blind spots for the problems that were occurring. So when I do testing, I sort of knew each section of the testing process that was vulnerable, and I'd be really careful subconsciously not to break it at that point. But someone who's actually using the software, I mean, they're going to be distracted and be like, ooh, what's that thing over there? I'm going to click that, and they'll do crazy things that normally users are going to do. So I quickly learned that I should really have someone else be doing the testing for me. And also, if you think you need to be a developer for testing, please don't be a developer for testing. We need a lot of really normal people who are actually going to be using the software doing testing because they're going to, you know, do a lot more crazy things and break it in horrible ways before we do a release, and that's very helpful. So testing. Also, testing's gotten much easier in the past few years. Now with virtualization, anyone who's got a reasonably modern system can install something like VirtualBox and really easily get a pristine Linux install up in 10 minutes. And then from there, you can install some crazy development software and do testing against it, and then not mess up your own system, not break your MP3 library with a zillion songs loaded into it because you wanted to test Banshee. There's also really cheap USB sticks that are large enough to hold an ISO. This really helps for ISO testing because you no longer have to have a CD-ROM drive or a CD to test a release of a beta release or an alpha release of an operating system. So USB sticks have made it much easier too, so you can do live system testing. So testing is good, and lots of good ways to get involved in that. Design. So open source projects have gotten a lot better in the past few years about design and user interface and pretty websites. I used to use Debian as an example of someone who has a really horrible website, but they redid their website this year. So, hey Debian. but there are still some open source software sites that may need site work done on their website. When each new release of an operating system is released, usually they have different desktop backgrounds that they need people to do stuff for. Icon sets are something that people need design for. So that gives me another story of a project I was involved with. I really hate cooking, so I've done all these things to make myself like cooking. I have a pile of cookbooks like this big, because every time I see a cookbook, I'm like, oh, that'll make me cook more. I think I bought the O'Reilly book, Cooking for Geeks, as well. That didn't help me, either. I bought cooking video games for the Nintendo DS. I started a cooking blog, because I thought if I was like geeking out over the ingredients and taking pictures of the whole process, that would make me cook more. That lasted about 2 weeks. So finally, being me, I decided to join an open source project about cooking. So I joined the Gourmet Recipe Manager software project, and it's pretty much just indexing software for recipes. And it has pictures, and it has cook times, and it has ways to export grocery shopping lists, and it's a really cute piece of software. It didn't help me cook, because apparently nothing will. But I did the Debian packaging for them for a while. So I'm on their development mailing list, and the lead developer of the project was working on a new search API for the software. And he's like, listen, I'm working on this new search API, and it can now display pictures with your recipes when you do searches. So if you have a picture in there of the recipe, it'll pop it up on the screen. But I also need some pictures, like default icons, default pictures for ones that don't have photos. So he sends this mail to the development list, and the development list is quiet for a few days. And 3 days later, this pops up on the mailing list. It's a really slick set of icons. It turns out one of the other developers on the mailing list knew a graphic designer who said he was happy to volunteer to help out. So within just a couple of days, he had this really slick icon set created, and it's what the project still uses today. This is like 3 years ago, I think. So that was a really, really awesome way for a designer to get involved. He wasn't really involved with the project prior to that, but just because he knew someone in open source who was like, you know, he made himself available, he was able to get done. If you're interested in design, making yourself available is really important, because there are people like me who go to a lot of conferences and handle a lot of booths and give out a lot of flyers. I'm always talking to people about open source, so it's nice for me to have something to give out. So last year, there was a Linux picnic in the Bay Area, and I was looking to make our table really pretty, because it was outside, and I was trying to think, like, how can I make this stand out in the beautiful scenery we have around us? So I asked a friend of mine up in Massachusetts to put together a flyer to sit on our table. And this is from Martin Owens. He does some software development, but he also does a lot of design, and clearly he's very good at it. So he made this poster for me, and it's now one of the most popular reasons to love Ubuntu, like Ubuntu promotional photos out there in the community. So if you're a designer, let me know, and I'll give you lots of unpaid work. community is another way to get involved. I'd say that me standing here giving you a presentation about contributing to open source is a community thing. Also things like running the Philadelphia Linux Users Group, which Paul is doing now, that's a community thing. There's a lot of administrative administrative stuff that goes on in projects, making sure your website is up and stays up. That may be more of a sysadmin thing, but it's someone at least needs to track that it's still working, and if your project is a blog, they have to make sure it's being updated. Within the Ubuntu project, there are tons of little projects related to Ubuntu, and a lot of those can be filed under community because there are things like mentoring programs, local teams that are working on stuff within their community to support schools and other places that they might be putting Ubuntu in. So there's a lot of community work out there if you're not ready to contribute a technical thing, or if you don't ever want to contribute a technical thing. If you're really just interested in getting open source to more people and facilitating that, getting involved in community things is really important. And since we're in Pennsylvania, I will say that right now, Pennsylvania Ubuntu team really needs some volunteers. They had a bunch of us move away all at once. So they're sort of leaderless. So their current leader's trying to hand off the project to someone else. There are a lot of people who are interested in helping with the Ubuntu team right now, but there's no one really getting out there and planning events and starting things. So if you plan an event, especially around Philly, I can pretty much guarantee people will come to it, but we need the people who are going to be planning events. So if you have any questions about getting involved with Ubuntu Pennsylvania, let me know, or go to their website, ubuntupennsylvania.org. You can just Google for Ubuntu Pennsylvania. They have a mailing list, and there's a thread on the mailing list for the current lead of the projects that help, I need help with this. And no one's replied, so it's kind of indicative of the problem. So hop on the mailing list if you're interested and try to get involved. Because the Pennsylvania team used to do a lot of really awesome stuff, but when some key people move away, it can be very hard to keep things going. So now that you know why you want to contribute and some of the ways you can, how would you go about doing it? This slide has a bit of a story behind it. I was at a software development forum a few months ago. There were five of us on this panel, and we were talking about getting involved in open source. So the question came up, okay, I'm interested, I want to go do this, what do I do now? Like, how do I start? So of the five of us on the panel, four of us are sitting there saying, you should visit their website, see if there's a join now button, see if there's a get involved button. Up on their mailing lists or IRC or forums or whatever thing you're most comfortable with. And then get a feel for the community and try to get involved in all that stuff. So we're all sitting there chatting away about happy, friendly communities and getting involved and getting familiar with everything, reading 10 years of archives. And this one woman on the panel is looking at us like we're all crazy people. And she's like, I've never done any of that stuff. All I ever do is just submit patches and then I'm on my way. So that made me realize there's a lot of ways to get involved in open source and get started. So while I may say that going to the website, moving around, getting a feel for the community, and joining all these things is a really good way to get involved, it is very possible that you may just want to go and submit a patch and then move on. And that's perfectly fine too. So first steps, just some suggestions. Some things to watch out for when you first get involved. First of all, not every project is active. There's hundreds of thousands of projects on the source forge right now, and I can guarantee most of them are not active. They haven't had a release in years. They were put up there, maybe not touched very much. So if you find an open source project that's not very active, first of all, be prepared to do everything in that project if you really want to get it going again, because all the people who originally contributed may be unavailable or not interested anymore. You also may be prepared to work with the original people who are on it, but they're all so busy right now that you have to have some patience with working with them. So I'd suggest you probably don't want to start with a project that's been dead for a while, because it's helpful to have people there to help you out with the workflow and getting familiar with the software. So you might not want to join one like that. You also probably want to avoid really huge projects that don't have any clear mentoring framework and have a really high barrier to entry. This can be projects like Firefox, actually, is a really awesome open source project, but actually getting code committed to it can be pretty hard because they've got a really core group of developers and they've got a lot of established contributors. And again, they've got a foundation behind them, so there's a lot of procedural stuff in there. And the barrier to entry is really high because this is a huge, very popular open source project. That they really need to be careful with and and make sure that the people committing code are really high quality programmers and contributors. So while you should probably get involved in a huge awesome project like that at some point, I wouldn't suggest it for your first project because it's hard. I'd also avoid ones that are run by companies and then over the fence style. This pretty much means they do development in-house, and then when they're ready to do a release, they toss the software out in the open. And even though I have one, I'm sorry to say Android is an example of this. Google does all the development in-house, and they don't really talk to the community at all. So while it is an open source project, strictly speaking, it's not a very open project when it comes to getting involved. So Android is a horrible project to get involved with. I don't even know if you can in any real way. And that's actually not a horrible example of a project like that. There are projects that are even much worse. And then an example of one with a high barrier entry and an over the fence style would be Chromium. sorry to bust on Google. My fiance actually works there, so I don't know. Chromium was sort of over the fence, and it is now community developed. But Google still holds a lot of the keys to that project. The development work tools for that is a mix of different revision control systems, so it's really hard for people outside of Google to get involved with it. So in addition to having a really high barrier to entry because it's a very complex product with a lot of complex tools, it was really developed in-house, so it's hard really for outsiders to get involved. Another thing to watch out for, if you work in the tech industry, you may have restrictions placed upon you by your employer about what you can contribute to in open source. You may even have problems with copyright assignment because you may have signed something when you got hired that says all the copyrighted code that you write belongs to your company. And that creates a conflict when you're contributing to an open source project and you have to sign a copyright assignment with that project as well. This is where I bust on Ubuntu now, because for a lot of the canonical products, like Unity, you have to sign a contributor agreement reassigning copyright to the canonical company. And a lot of people don't like that, and it conflicts with a lot of work agreements. So there are things about licensing and copyright you should be aware of. And if you're not sure that you can contribute in a way, you may just want to talk to your boss or talk to HR or, you know, the company lawyer and make sure that it's okay. So you've found an open source project you want to contribute to, you've gotten familiar with it in a way that you feel is sufficient, you've watched out for all those things, you found a really good project. Just some tips for getting involved. The first one is probably obvious, respect other contributors. It can be easy to forget sometimes that the people you're talking to, if you're working from your home office and you're in IRC, it can be easy to forget that there are real people on the other end, and that a lot of you are volunteers. You're all working towards the same goal, so just be respectful to each other. Follow procedures in place for contributions. If you send Mark Shuttleworth a patch for something in Ubuntu, it's probably not going to get in Ubuntu because that's not the way you submit them. You probably won't even read it. So there are things, when you want to submit a patch, there are ways to go ahead and submit a patch. You don't send it to the lead developer because you think it's the best patch ever. This also helps avoid duplication of work. In the Debian project, when you want to start packaging a product, you file an intent to package, and that serves two purposes. It allows the community to know that you're working on something so that someone else doesn't start creating the package. It also allows the community to give time to comment. So if someone has recently packaged something similar, or they tried to package the same thing 3 years ago and you didn't go back to the archives and look for it, they can say, oh yeah, someone tried that already. Don't waste your time because the license is all a mess and you can't fix it. So it gives, there are a lot of reasons for procedures for contributions. So I'd say follow them and do your best to abide by them at all times when you're contributing. I'd say follow through with commitments, especially when you're volunteering. It can be easy to say, like, I'm not being paid for this and it's not really that important. And you'll take on tasks that you want to do at the time, and then you won't follow through with them because something else came up and you don't notify the project and you just get busy. Please don't do that because it's really disruptive for the project. It makes people not really be able to trust you, because the next time a project thing comes along and you say you volunteer to do it, we're like, you didn't do the last one, it's going to be really hard for us to trust you to do this one. So just, if you can't follow through with the commitment, let the people you're working with know. Because I can't think of a time when someone said they couldn't follow through with the commitment and just told the project that outright and said, I signed up for this 2 weeks ago and I can't actually do it because something came up. 9 times out of 10, I mean, every single time I've seen it. Everyone in the project's like, okay, cool, thanks for letting us know, and then they move on and assign to someone else. So it's really better, if you can't follow through, to just let the project know and say, I can't do this thing that I said I'm going to do. Avoid insulting the work of your predecessors. Obviously, you're not going to be insulting everyone, you're not a mean person, but this is, I've seen this happen accidentally. Someone joins a project and they see all these problems and they say, they decide to mail the list and be like, I see that this and this and this is horrible. I'm going to fix it with this and this. And they think they're being really helpful because they're going to fix all these major problems. While you're saying everything is horrible, you're insulting the work that someone else did. And oftentimes they're a volunteer or someone who spent a lot of really, serious work time on this. So just keep that in mind when you're sending the mail to the list or talking in a meeting that you want to make sure your dialogue is positive and helpful in that way, so not insulting in any way. Focus on constructive criticism and feedback when you're in your dialogue with the project. This sort of goes back to being familiar with the culture of a project. I've seen people get really excited about a new project that they join and have no respect for any of the history of the project. And so they decide to reply to every development mailing list thread. They're really active in meetings and talking a lot, and they just end up being noisy. So while you're excited and while it can be really good to have that excitement, I just temper that a little bit and sort of get a feel for how the project is and how people bring up criticism and comments, and make sure the things that you say matter, because otherwise people are just going to start ignoring you and it's not going to be very helpful. My final one here is don't fork a project. For people not familiar, forking is when you take an existing code base and create a new branch and then your own project where you decide that you want to take development in some other direction and the rest of the project is not interested in. I'm saying don't do this because this is an introduction to open source project, or a presentation, and it's not something that should be taken lightly. It's not something that you should do. And I say almost every time I've seen a project be forked, the fork has failed because the person doing it was not very experienced. They didn't realize how much effort would be involved in maintaining a fork. Once you fork a project, you become the sole maintainer of that. You end up having to fix all the security vulnerabilities. You have to pull in all new changes from the old code if you're interested in having them. And then you have to roll the releases and everything on your own. So first of all, it might fail if you fork. It also really creates bad feelings between yourself and the original project most of the time, because forking is pretty much frowned upon. And of course, I have seen there are successful forks out there. But these were all done by committed members core members of projects who had serious problems that couldn't be resolved otherwise. And they took half the contributors and went off on this fork in a different direction. And usually it's been done in a sort of peaceful way. Xorg is actually an example of a successful fork. So if you're new and then don't really know, don't fork. It's bad. And the last thing I have to say about getting involved is have fun with it. Even if you're working for a company and doing open source contributions that way, there are a lot of opportunities to meet people, attend conferences, hopefully ones with air conditioning, meet lots of people and travel places, and you can really have fun with it. So I encourage you to definitely have fun with it. And if you stop having fun with it, especially if you're a volunteer, I'd say maybe take a break or move on to something else or change your workflow a little bit. It's really easy to get burned out when you start feeling like everything you're doing for open source is now work and a burden. So I've taken a few times where I've had to take an analysis of everything I'm working on and decide. side, what am I procrastinating on all the time? What am I not enjoying anymore? And then really take a look at about whether I can refocus my efforts. So, yeah, that's a little bit. And that's pretty much it. So, questions?
I just have a question. I think I heard it correctly. You refer to a canonical project.
The question was what's a canonical project? That's very confusing because canonical is an actual word in the dictionary. But canonical that I was referring to is a company that's behind the Ubuntu project. They sponsor Ubuntu and they put a lot of money and development work into it. So I'd say a canonical project is a in that sense is a project that's sponsored by Canonical. Canonical is behind the Unity interface. They also have projects like Ubuntu One, which is a software as a service. It's sort of like a Dropbox, but it has more things. You can buy music through it, and you can do other things through it. So that's another product by Canonical. And there are lots of little clients for that. Launchpad.net is the contribution framework for Ubuntu. So instead of using something like SourceForge or Google Code, they're using Launchpad, which is now an open source project, but it was originally a closed source project created by Canonical.
Say you're a developer and you do your own thing, so I'm looking at it from a different angle. You have some code, not necessarily big packages like I think a lot of your examples were, but like libraries, you'd like to get out there and maybe solicit, you know, say, hey, you should use this. This is a better image processing library than anyone's using. Have you seen anything like that?
That is a good question. So if you have existing code and you want to release it, how do you get it out there, do it, release all that? That is a good question. So what I'd say is, first of all, put the project and any revisions you may have up in a public place so people can see, you know, if you've got it in revision control, you know, toss the whole tree up there so
right.
People can see the history and all that stuff. On anything like Google Code or Launchpad or any of the three free ones out there. And then as far as really getting it out there, a lot of development lists, especially for operating systems like Fedora or Ubuntu, there will be discussions each cycle about the core things to include and use this on in the operating system. So maybe getting involved in those discussions when they start talking about image processing or different libraries to use. Projects like Ubuntu and Fedora, they're really the cutting edge of what is in Linux distributions these days. So they've made some pretty drastic changes. Like they removed the GIMP from Ubuntu a while back and replaced it with FSpot, which is just a photo editing thing. It's a very simple editor. They also, Ubuntu switched from the GDM, the GNOME login manager and session manager, to LightDM this session because someone was saying, listen, GDM is big and heavy. We want to switch to something lighter. So that's definitely welcome in a lot of those discussions. Proposing something new or proposing something different. That's where you can get stuck in your project.
Typically big software companies have a software manager and testing and then, you know, one of the developers. For an open source project, how does leadership typically go forward?
The question was in big software companies and stuff, you've got tech leads and you've got all these roles within a software company. And how does open source projects It depends on the project, of course, but in big open source projects, you will have those similar roles. And again, depending on the project, how that forms, it's often organic in open source projects. Even something big like Ubuntu, Ubuntu started off with just a bunch of Debian developers who wanted something new. And from there is now a technical board, there's now a community council. Those were sort of the core beginning ones. And from there, when the tech board got sick of approving all new developers all by themselves, they created a membership board for that. The community council has spun off into a council that handles IRC, a council that handles forums, a council that handles... There's a council for everything now. And they all just sort of came about when the need was there. And the same thing comes for the technical lead role leads in a project. Usually they're formed organically by someone who is in a position of leadership, even if it wasn't called that, and then moved on from there. And, you know, they got a title eventually because the project got big, and someone said, "Oh, you should be our tech lead because you're already our."
if you don't know what you're doing is special or how it differs from previous collaborators, how many are familiar with the existing solutions? So therefore, how can we distinguish between them? Is it actually